to be gathered in his presence and learn at his feet. Let's open our mouth and praise the name of the Lord. It is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because his compassions, they fail not. Great is the faithfulness of the Lord our God, who saw through last year, who has started with us again. Day one had gone, the second day in his presence, to learn at his feet. Let's open our mouth and give him the praise. Let's open our mouth and worship and adore him. For the Lord is good, and his mercy endures forever. Let's thank the Lord who has not taken our teacher away from us. Let's bless the name of the Lord year after year. New strength, wisdom, and power bestowed upon him to teach the words of the Lord uncompromisingly. Let's bless the name of the Lord for all this. It's a privilege that even now that there is the doubt, there is the scarcity of the word of God, we still have the privilege to have it in abundance. Let's bless God, let's praise him, let's worship him, for he is good. In Jesus' name we pray. We are here gathered in his presence to learn at his feet. Want to tell him that none of us will be dull of hearing. The Lord, by the magnet of his word, will draw us closer to himself. Let's open our mouth and pray. And he will grant unto us the grace to obey his word. As we hear, there will be doers of his word, that our obedience to God's word this year will be more than it has ever been, and will be ready to do his will always. Let's open our mouths and pray. Let's pray for our brethren on their way coming, that the Lord will remove all hindrances out of their pathways and bring them in here safely. In Jesus' name we pray. We have other people that will be ministering with our Father in the Lord, the choristers and all our brethren in the ushering section and everyone in the electronics department. Let's pray that the Spirit of God will rest upon everyone. Shall we open our mouths and pray? That the Spirit of God will rest upon everyone, the hands of the Lord will rest upon everyone, and the Lord will make everyone to officiate as oracles of God, as God's ministers. In Jesus' name we pray. Want to pray and tell the Lord, the Apostle Paul says, my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Want to pray that the power of God will rest upon the words of his servants today, and that reading that word to us, applying the word, that every need will be met by reading and application of the word of God. Shall we pray? Let's open our mouth and pray that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. The Lord will help him, the Lord will assist him, empower him, and pick up his word by the power of the Holy Spirit, upon the wing of the Spirit of God, to reach our hearts and resolve every doubt, and melt away all confusion, in the things of God that we'll be able to live the way the Lord expects us to. And everywhere, world over, that the Spirit of God will take up the word, and the word will reach out to souls that will be converted. Those who are confused, confusion will disappear, will be dispelled by the word of God, and the name of the Lord God will be glorified. Let's tell the Lord also that the Lord God of heaven and earth will help us, every one of us, to earnestly contend to the faith once delivered unto the saint this year and for the rest of our lives. Let's open our mouth and pray. And let's tell the Lord also that as the GCK continues this year, the one coming up in Asaba will lead to practical encounter with Christ, unforgettable encounter with the Lord in every life, and that the name of the Lord God will be glorified. Such encounter that will change life and change histories and transform homes. Let's open our mouth that that will happen during the Asaba GCK. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father in heaven, we are here gathered before you to learn at your feet. Speak to us, Lord, as we hear, give us the grace to obey you, to do your will and live according to your expectations for our lives here below in Jesus' name, so that at the end we will be qualified to live with you eternally in Jesus' name. Commit your servant into your hands today, O Lord God, that you will take up his word by the power of the Holy Ghost to reach to many our hearts, that everyone hearing will receive divine strength to obey and to live according to your word in Jesus' name. Our brethren who are yet to be here, on their way coming, of those who are still thinking, considering to come or not, I pray that the magnetic power of your Spirit we reach out to everyone, remove hindrances and stumbling blocks out of their ways, and bring them in here, that all of us together will learn at your feet and will be blessed, our lives will be transformed, your name will be glorified in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing us here into your presence. Thank you, Lord, for this new year. Thank you for sustaining us till now. We say, Lord, let your name be glorified forever in Jesus' name. Lord, we commit our program tonight into your hands. We pray, Lord, have your way, take control. Let your name be glorified. Feed us with your word, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, we commit this session into your hands. Lord, we pray. Let the heaven be opened and let our praises be acceptable in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah!
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lift up Jesus, he is King of Kings. Lift up Jesus, he is Lord of Lords. Lift up Jesus, he is King of Kings, King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. Let us lift him up. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. King of Kings, King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. Brethren, lift him higher. Amen. Lift up Jesus. He is King of Kings. Lift up Jesus. He is Lord of Lords. Lift up Jesus. He is King of Kings, King of Kings, and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Messiah is the King of Kings. Messiah is the Lord of Lords. Messiah is the King of Kings. Messiah is the Lord. Lords, hallelujah. We will sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. Messiah. In heaven it is settled forever and ever, O Lord. Oh, it's settled forever, O Lord. Forever. Lord, thy word is settled in heaven, it is settled forever and ever. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. Wonderful to know. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. Wonderful to know. My Savior died for me. My Savior. It's wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. Wonderful to know, to know. Wonderful. Hallelujah. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died. Wonderful. Amen. My Savior died for me. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Wonderful to know. It is wonderful to know. Amen. To know He died for me. Hallelujah. It is wonderful to know that Jesus died for me. Wonderful to know. Thy word is life, thy word is spirit. Write your word, O Lord, on the table of my heart. Thy word is life, thy word is spirit. Write your word, O Lord, on the table of my heart. It's life. Thy word is life, thy word is spirit. Write your word, O Lord, on the table of my heart. Thy word is life, thy word is spirit. Write your word, O Lord, on the table of my heart. Come believing, come believing, come to Jesus, look and live. Come believing, come believing, come to Jesus, look and live, look and live. Look and live, come believing. Look and live, come believing, come believing. Look and live, come believing. Oh, deep quiet I pray, and I every day, and wise are blessed, Lord, in thy precious holy word. Oh, deep quiet I pray. Every day, and wise are blessed, Lord, in thy precious holy word, O depart. Yet I pray. Every day, and wise our blessed Lord. Deeper, deeper in the love of Jesus, daily let me go. Higher, higher in the school of wisdom, more of grace to know. Oh, deeper. Deeper yet I pray. Higher every day. Jesus, day after day, I live for Jesus. Let's come with me, the Holy Spirit, I will obey. I live for Jesus, day after day, day after day. Day after day. Let's come, watch me. Whole day after day. Day after day. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp, keep me burning. Keep me burning till the close of the day. Give me oil. Lord, keep me burning. Lord, I pray. Keep me burning. Give me oil. Keep me burning. Keep me burning till the close of the, closer to thee, Lord, draw me closer, closer to thee, closer to thee, closer to thee, Lord, draw me closer, closer to thee. Oh, my prayer every day.
Amen. I want to welcome every one of us for the Bible studies tonight in Jesus' name. It's always our pleasure to recognize the presence of our visitors, neighbors, and colleagues who are studying the Word of God with us for the very first time. Therefore, if you are in our midst today for the first time, you've been invited, you've been one of our converts, or you are a visitor in Lagos and you just came around to study the Word of God, want to recognize you, want to give you the greetings from our pastor. Can you please raise up your hand wherever you are? Thank you very much. You can stand up so that we can recognize you. You may not need to do that. You are welcome in Jesus' name. We have our brethren beside you, our ushers, and they will give you slips of paper to fill. Please put in the correct information, as this will assist the church to reach out to you better and be of greater assistance to you. Our Bible studies here tonight brings together our brethren from Gbagada, Shomolu, Ketu, and Yaba. We have three important meetings in the church. We have the Sunday worship service, And we have the Monday Bible study as we are now, as well as the Thursday revival service, which take place in our various district. Next Sunday combined service will bring together our brethren from Group 2, while those of us in Group 1 will be on our district basis. The Tuesday leadership meeting for the month of January will be on all district bases, with the exception of the one that falls within the GCK period. Saturday workers' meeting also will be on group basis. And next Sunday, by the grace of God, if Jesus tarries, we shall be having the new convert banquet by 3:30 p.m., that's Sunday, 8th of January. And we expect that every one of us will reach out to our converts and take them to the locations in our various old district. Then also, the Monday Bible study for next week will be bringing our brethren from Agege to join us, Bagada, Shomolu, Ketu, as regular congregation of the GS for the Monday Bible study. We'll now take our congregational hymns. Let's rise on our feet. Our congregational hymn will be taken from our Gospel Hymns and Songs, number 42. Gospel Hymns and Songs, number 42. Close to thee. Thou, my everlasting portion, more than friend or life to me, all along my pilgrim journey, Savior, let me walk with thee. Close to thee, close to thee, all along my pilgrim journey, Savior, let me walk with thee. Not for ease or worldly pleasure, nor for fame my prayer shall be. Gladly will I toil and suffer, only let me walk with thee. Close to thee, close to thee, gladly will I toil and suffer, only let me walk with thee. Lead me through the veil of shadows, bear me all life's fitful sea, then the gate of life eternal may I enter, Lord, with thee. Close to thee, close to thee. Then the gate of life eternal may I enter, Lord, with thee.
Toil and suffer,
Today we are going to continue with our Bible reading. But before we read, shall we just have a moment of prayer? Father, we are asking that you will open our eyes of understanding as we read your word today. We are asking that relevant passages that really speak to our present needs and problems, spiritually and physically and materially, you will impress upon our hearts. Be with us, enlighten us, instruct us, teach us as we read together now. In Jesus' name, I pray. We'll continue with the reading now.
Genesis
chapter 49.
Genesis
chapter 49. And Jacob called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. Gather yourselves together and hear, ye sons of Jacob, and hearken unto Israel your father. Reuben, thou art my firstborn, my might, and the beginning of my strength, the excellency of dignity, and the excellency of power, unstable as water. Thou shalt not excel, because thou wentest up to thy father's bed, then defilest thou it. He went up to my couch. Simeon and Levi are brethren. Instruments of cruelty are in their habitations. O my soul, come not thou into their secret. Unto their assembly, mine honor, be not thou united. For in their anger they slew a man, and in their self-will they digged down a wall. Cursed be their anger, for it was fierce, and their wrath, for it was cruel. I will divide them in Jacob, and scatter them in Israel. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, he couched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be. Binding his foal unto the vine, and his ass's colt unto the choice vine, he washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes shall be red with wine, and his teeth white with milk. Zebulun shall dwell at the haven of the sea, and he shall be for an haven of ships, and his border shall be unto Zidon. Issachar is a strong ass, couching down between two burdens. And he saw that rest was good, and the land that it was pleasant, and bowed his shoulder to bear, and became a servant unto tribute. Dan shall judge his people, as one of the tribes of Israel. Dan shall be a serpent by the way, an adder in the path that biteth the horse heels, so that his rider shall fall backward. I have waited for thy salvation, O Lord. Gad, a troop shall overcome him, but he shall overcome at the last. Out of Asher his bread shall be fat, and he shall yield royal dainties. Naphtali is a hind let loose. He giveth goodly words. Joseph is a fruitful bough, even a fruitful bough by a well, whose branches run over the wall. The archers have sorely grieved him, and shot at him, and hated him. But his bow abode in strength, and the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From thence is the shepherd, the stone of Israel. Even by the God of thy father, who shall help thee, and by the Almighty, who shall bless thee with blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep that lieth under, blessings of the breasts and of the womb. The blessings of thy father have prevailed above the blessings of my progenitors unto the utmost bound of the everlasting hills. They shall be on the head of Joseph, and on the crown of the head of him that was separate from his brethren. Benjamin shall raven as a wolf. In the morning he shall devour the prey, and at night he shall divide the spoil. All these are the 12 tribes of Israel. And this is it that their father spake unto them, and blessed them. Every one according to his blessing he blessed them. And he charged them, and said unto them, I am to be gathered unto my people. Bury me with my fathers in the cave that is in the field of Ephron the Hittite, in the cave that is in the field of Machpelah, which is before Mamre, in the land of Canaan, which Abraham bought with the field of Ephron the Hittite for the possession of a burying place. There they buried Abraham and Sarah his wife. There they buried Isaac and Rebekah his wife. And there I buried Leah. The purchase of the field and of the cave that is therein was from the children of Heth. And when Jacob had made an end of commanding his sons, he gathered up his feet into the bed, and yielded up the ghost, and was gathered unto his people.
You have just listened to the Bible reading, and we need to take whatever we have learned to the Lord in prayer. Will you all rise up, please? Talk to the Lord in prayer. You've seen a commandment, a warning, an example, an instruction to obey, a promise to claim. Pray for grace that you will do as you have learned in the Word of God. In Jesus' name we pray.
We remain standing as we give our tithes and our offering. And before we read, we give our read from Luke's Gospel. Gospel according to St. Luke. In chapter 6, I'll read verse 38. Give, and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that ye measure, withal it shall be measured to you again. Let's raise up what that which will brought us to pray together. Father, we thank you so much for the privilege of giving. I pray that all that your children are raising up now be sanctified and accepted from every heart given in Jesus' name. And pray that you take it up and use it in expansion of your kingdom here on earth in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We have our brethren with the bags. Please, let's drop it in the offering bag.
Thank you. right beside me, and nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide, hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Thy word,
thy
is,
word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Thy word.
Set apart for you.
Set apart for you.
what you said to me, Jesus. I believe what you said to me, Jesus. I believe what you said to me.
Though the world should all forsake me, I will never fear or dread. For you said that you go with me. And
Jesus, I believe what you said.
Though the sky is gray above me, though I cannot see ahead, protect me. And
Jesus, I believe what you said.
Oh yes,
I believe you really love me.
You really love me.
I believe you really care. I believe you
died to save me.
We're blinded. You took my hands and gently lead. Oh, how sweet it is to trust you.
And
Jesus, I believe what you said.
I believe what you say.
I believe.
Jesus, I believe.
Yeah. test your mind. Put away your fear.
We need a new visitation, a new postulation leading to a new proclamation.
What wise men, great men, medical men, professional people have not been able to do, God will do it. All those things that are forgotten, your forgotten strength, your forgotten power, your forgotten revelation, everything you said, I had a dream long ago, and I thought, this is what I will do, I've forgotten now, your forgotten vision will come up again. Passion will come up again. Revelation will come up again. New life will come up again in your life in Jesus' name.
Only Christ Jesus has the power of this new year.
An unforgettable encounter beckons. We are connecting to the God of wonders this new year for salvation and deliverance. Welcome GCK to Asaba, Delta State, Nigeria, January 26th to 31st, 2023.
1600 hours GMT daily and global Sunday worship at 0700 hours GMT. Also featuring ministers and professionals conference with Impact Academy for Youth, Young Adults and Young Professionals. It's a new year of wonders this 2023.
From the Niger Delta, the oil of anointing will be transported by satellite and all our social media links to over 150 countries of the world. Join the teeming GCK audience as the man appointed by God, the convener of GCK, Pastor Dr. W.F. Kumuyi, connects the world to an unforgettable encounter with the God of wonders. Glorious music ministrations by choirs from nations across the world, with guest music ministration by Jonathan Lee.
Darkness gone. Yes. Premature death cancelled. Yes. Yours is now to reap the benefit.
GCK, the gospel to every creature.
So, when they are dying, Jesus says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He says unto him, yea, Lord, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, feed my lambs. He says unto him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He says unto him, yea, Lord, yes, Lord, that knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, feed my sheep. He says unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he says unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus says unto him, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. There's a famine in the land. And this is the time when people, they run here, they run there, they cannot find the word of God. And if we don't get to those lambs, if we don't get to those new converts, if we don't get to those people, the famine in the land will not help, will not help. There's a famine of hearing the word of the Lord in the land. See Paul the Apostle, when those converts were won, when those new churches were planted, he taught them. He taught them from A to Z. Great will be the opportunity for the man. Great the opportunity for the woman that can say, yes, Lord, you know that I love you with all my heart and with all my soul and with all my might. More than business, more than profession, more than work, more than money, more than material things. Yes, Lord, I love you. But if you're still struggling with that, look at the fish. And look at the marketing, and look at the business opportunities, and you cannot give up. You cannot give up a material thing. You cannot give up the pieces of fish. You cannot give up the game. You cannot give up the profession. And when your profession contradicts or it comes contrary, it kind of collides with the work and the calling of God upon your life, you cannot say, yes, I give it up. Yes, I give it up. Because yes, Lord, I love you more than all these things. then you cannot feed. It's not just a matter of saying, I know some verses of the Bible, I know some scriptures, I'm ready, I'm going to go out now in my spare time, in the fragment of time I want to give, in the little time I want to surrender, I'm going to feed the lambs. No, not at all. It's not looking for fragment. It's looking for your whole heart and your whole mind. It's looking for everything you've got, and he wants you to answer the question, lovest thou me more than these, before you can reach out and say, I'm going to feed the lambs. Now, if you know anything about the newcomers, if you know anything about the lambs, they have been having problems in the past with deception and with lying, and they were sin and with iniquity, and now you tell them, repent and be born again, repent and be converted. They repent and they are converted, and they come to know the Lord, and you see Christ said, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, I will come into him, and I will abide with him and sup with him and fellowship with him. And Christ is now on the inside. As you are feeding them, you assure them, the remnant of Israel shall not do iniquity. They will not continue in sin, nor speak lies. They will not continue in their lying. Neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth, because they shall feed and lie down, and none shall make them afraid. Luke was going to write something to a convert, a single convert, and he took it from chapter 1 to chapter 2, all through to chapter 24, and then later I was going to write Acts of the Apostles. Who did he write Acts of the Apostles to? To Theophilus. And he was going to write about the history of Israel, so that this new convert will be solid, and this new convert will know what he ought to know. And he wrote 28 chapters of the Acts of the Apostles, and he gave every detail, every minute detail. That's what we ought to do, to make sure that the word of God is enriching the life of the people, the word of the Lord is making the people strong. You will do it as I'm doing it in Jesus' name. Your converts will be strong in Jesus' name. They will desire the sincere milk of the word, that they may grow thereby. They will grow in Jesus' name. When the trumpet shall sound and the saints shall go marching in, I'll see you marching in. And then I see for the people following you, 1, 2, 3, 10, 20, 30, 100. And I said, who are these people? You say, they are the lambs and they are the sheep that God helped me to feed. You will succeed in the work of God. Rise up and tell the Lord, I will. Yes, Lord, I love you. Yes, Lord, I love you. And I'm going to feed the lambs. I'm going to feed the sheep. I'm going to feed the people of God.
the way they will go. The same message, the same doctrine, the same teaching that have been committed to us, the same commit to others who will be able to teach others also. We need to do this job and do it well so that through us, many will be established. Through us, many souls will be strengthened. Through us, disciples will be nurtured, strengthened, fortified to serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. We will train them up also to serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord. We will equip them also to serve the Lord. We will serve the Lord and we will guide them also to serve the Lord. That's the job of a discipler. That's the job of a trainer. That's the job of a true disciple. Teach them, feed them, nourish them, and make them fruitful and productive. That is the job. Tell the Lord, I will serve the Lord. I will worship the Lord in the work. I will show my adoration and my yieldedness and my worship by serving honorably, faithfully, reverently, diligently, fruitfully. Every day, I will serve the Lord. 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 I'll preach the word of the Lord. Declare the counsel of the Lord. Teach the people. Nourish the new converts. Establish them in the way of the Lord, in the counsel of the Lord, in the truth that sets free, the truth that fortifies, the truth that sanctifies. Lord, here am I. Help me faithfully, diligently to do this job. Faithfully, diligently, fruitfully, every day, every time, everywhere, I will serve the Lord. I will preach the gospel and I will disciple saved souls. I will feed the lamb. I will do the work of an evangelist. We have the challenge of Luke, the beloved, who wrote 24 chapters as a follow-up teaching for Theophilus. And thereafter, 28 chapters of the book of Acts, also as a follow-up teaching, instruction, admonition to the same person. And that letter, that record, that write-up has been the source of encouragement, source of blessing to the whole world up until now. Let's pray. Lord, help me. Help me faithfully, diligently, to also teach, minister, write, and do all that needs to be done to disciple souls, to strengthen souls, to establish souls in the way of the Lord, in the counsel of the Lord, in the will of the Lord. Help me, O Lord, to serve you faithfully, fruitfully every day, diligently every day. We will give them word of encouragement, word of assurance. We will make ourselves example of true believers unto the people that we are leading. We will do it with joy, with excitement, with zeal, with commitment, not mechanically, not grudgingly, not as though we have been forced to do it, but with joy, with zeal, with enthusiasm, so that our zeal will provoke others. Our zeal will also be a mentoring zeal and encouraging zeal. The commitment that will also help others to see what it means to be servants of the Lord and help them also to be committed. This is the work. This is the assignment. This is what the Lord expects from every one of us. We must do it. And we will do it in Jesus' name. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for this church. We thank you for the command and the commitment you are calling us into. We're pleading, O God, that you help every one of us every day, every time, everywhere to be actively, faithfully involved in the service of our King in Jesus' name. We will show our love. We will demonstrate our love by feeding the lamb, by feeding the sheep, so that they will all be nourished in the way of the Lord, established in the counsel of the Lord, and together they together will be fit for eternal rest, eternal joy at the end in Jesus' name. Give us more strength, more grace, more zeal, more commitment, more dedication to do this work and do it well to your glory and praise in Jesus' name. Lead us as we continue in this program. Help your servant that will be ministering. Our Father in the Lord, we pray you speak to him more unto us and let your blessing flow into our lives, not through this year and all the years of our life. We will serve you fruitfully to the end in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. A bigger amen.
Lord, I said, praise the Lord. I welcome everyone to the first Bible study, first Monday of this new year, 2023, in Jesus' name. Even though I saw some of you yesterday, but this is a new day. Happy New Year to everyone. That's all the Happy New Year you can give back. Praise the Lord. Are you happy? Because when a sad, sorrowful, depressed person is saying Happy New Year, that word happy will come out with an attitude of depression. But if you are happy inside yourself, and you are happy with what God is doing, and what God will do this new year, and the happiness is in your mind, in your soul, in your spirit, in your heart, everything within you, when that happy comes out, it will really be Happy New Year. God bless everyone in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for the Bible study tonight. Thank you for the new journey you are taking us through. Thank you for your word that brings everything we need into our lives. Something spiritual, something physical, something natural, something professional. Lord, we pray that this year will be a truly happy, holy, healthy year, hopeful life for everyone in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, that your word will do wonders in every life. We receive the word, we embrace the word, we believe the word, and then we act on the word, and great will be your blessing upon our lives this year in Jesus' name. Here at the headquarters and all the churches in Nigeria, Africa, America, everywhere, Lord, we pray that all over the globe, you will bless everyone tremendously in a very special way from this day until the end of the year in Jesus' name. Start with us, Lord. Teach us your word. Reveal your mind to us, and we pray that the blessing of the word will come upon every life, even tonight. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. God bless you. You can see that we're coming to Daniel chapter 1. In Daniel chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Open your Bible, please. Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. Look at verse 2 there. In verse 2 it says, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar and to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And then in verse 3 we're told, and the king spake unto Aspenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes. In verse 4, it tells us, children in whom was no blemish, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in in knowledge and understanding, science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. Then in verse 5, it says, and the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. In verse 6, it says, now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Ananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Reading from verse 7 now, it says, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Ananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and unto Azariah of Abednego. Now verse 8 says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, for nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. As we look at this, we are beginning the new year with what we have titled here, called Chosen and Faithful. That this year, as we begin our lives and we recollect how the Lord has called us, he called us to repentance, he called us to salvation, he called us to sanctification, he called us to holiness, he called us to service. And now we're talking about those who are called. And then many are called, but few are chosen. Those who are called and they respond to the call of God, they are chosen. They become the chosen treasure of God, the peculiar people of God, and the favorite people of God, because they have responded to the call that God has given. Number one, call; number two, chosen; and then faithful. It's one thing to be called, not everybody called responds. And it's one thing to be chosen, not everyone who has been chosen is faithful all the way through. But what a wonderful thing that you are called, that you are chosen, and that you are faithful. In this new year, from the beginning of this new year, and then as you move on, until the end, until the consummation, and then the blessings of those who are called, and the blessings of those who are chosen, and the blessings of those who are faithful will be upon every life in Jesus' name. We're dividing the message to three parts tonight. Number one, the captivity and challenge of the people. The people of Israel, the people of Judah, they had a challenge. The challenge is, they had not been living in the goodness of God. They had not been living in the covenant provision of the Lord. And now they were taken into captivity. Number two, the character of the chosen amidst the pollution. Well, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were some of the people carried away to captivity in the first deportation. They were deported from their land. They were taken from their land and were taken to the land of Babylon. Good people, saints of God, and faithful people of God, yet they were carried to captivity. They wouldn't understand why, but as we read the book of Daniel, we understand why God allowed that. We understand that he wanted Daniel to be a prophet to the Gentiles and a prophet to the Jews. If he had remained only in his country, only in Judah, he would have been a prophet only to Judah, to Jerusalem, but not to Babylon. He also be a prophet of God that will interpret the revelation of God to those, to that king, and to the son. And he will also show the prophecy to the children children of Israel, 70 weeks are determined upon your people. Without his being carried away like that, all that will not happen. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, without the deportation and without taking them out of their land unto the land of Babylon, we wouldn't have known that it is possible to fulfill literally the prophecy of Isaiah. When you go through the waters, you'll not be drowned. When you go through the fire, you will not be burnt. Even the flame shall not be kindled upon you. It's because they were carried away there that they could go through that same fire, and the fiery persecution, the fiery punishment could not burn them up. And so, although you may not know the reason why you are passing through this and passing through this, they are sinners. You know, Daniel might say, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego might have said, all these people are sinners. Why do the saints have the same lot as the sinners? Even though you don't understand, this year, whatever you understand, whatever you don't understand, just remain called and chosen and faithful. And at the end of the journey, the Lord will show you why. I will know why. I will know why. Point number three, the courage of conviction with purposeful purity. The courage of conviction. You see, there are people here on earth, they don't have any conviction. They go to synagogue, they go to sanctuary, they go to a temple, they go to assembly, they go to church building, and they worship every time. They go to Jerusalem, they go to the temple there, they go to all the various meetings there. They don't have any conviction. We cannot tell whether somebody has conviction or not until something happens. Anybody can say, I'm serving God, I'm following the Lord, and I will follow the Lord till I die. Until a problem happens, that now you are in a situation and you have a challenge, and then it is your courage that will show what your conviction is. It is your purpose. It is your determination. It is your diligence. It is your faithfulness. It is your obedience to the word of God that will show that you really have conviction. If you don't have conviction, when the wind blows, it will blow you in their direction, in the direction of the majority of the people. The way they live is the way you live. The way they talk is the way you talk. And the way they behave and act is the way you will behave and act, because you didn't have any conviction after all. But when somebody has conviction, whether daddy is there or mommy is there or not, whether the pastor is there or the priest is there or is not there, whether there are people to support and to lift up and to encourage and to counsel or not, you know, here is the conviction I have. In the case of Daniel, there was no pastor, no priest, there was no prophet, there was no counselor, there was no encourager, there was nobody to help him, but he purposed in his heart. That's a converted heart. And that is a convicted heart. And that is a heart that knows that whatever happens, I don't understand this, I don't understand that, but now I come to this situation because he had conviction. He said he purposed in his heart that he, whatever others do, that he, whatever others say, that he, whatever others counsel, that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, neither with the wine which he drank. And so he requested of the leader of the eunuchs that he would not defile himself. The courage of conviction with purposeful purity. Let's come to number one. Number one, we're looking at the captivity and challenge of the people. We're dividing this to three parts. Look at number one, the predicted captivity of unfaithful people. Number two is the perplexing condition of an unforeseen period. They did not foresee that period, that God could do that to them. Unseen period. Number three, the painful consequence of an unfixed past. Unfixed past. Unsettled past in the sight of the Lord. Let's look at number one. Number one is the predicted captivity of unfaithful people. Now, Judah should not pretend that he didn't know this was coming. Look at Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 29, and I'm reading from verse 9. Jeremiah 29, verse 9. For they prophesy falsely unto you in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. There were people that were telling the people of Judah, the people of Jerusalem, no problem, no problem. God is a good God. My God is not harsh. My God is not hard. My God is not bitter. God is love. So the prophets were telling the people of Judah, Jerusalem, the people of Israel. But Jeremiah said, they're not telling you the truth. Because God is a holy God, and God is a God of justice, and God is a God of judgment. Look at verse 10 there. In verse 10, for thus says the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, Jeremiah was telling them, you are going to Babylon. Captivity is coming. And after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in causing you to return to this place. Look at verse 14 there. In verse 14 it says, and I will be found of you, says the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity. Judah, captivity is coming. Judah, you're going to be in the captive dungeon of the Babylonians. And he says, it's after 70 years of return, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, says the Lord. The Lord says, it's not the power of Nebuchadnezzar that is able to get you out of Judah and get you to Babylon. It is me. God said, I have driven you. They were still in their land. And the Lord said, it's done. Take it, that is done. Judah, you are going to captivity. And it says, it's only after the 70 years, I'll take you away then from where I have driven you, says the Lord. And I will bring you again. I take you there. If you learn your lesson, if you repent, if you turn to the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, if you don't think that this Babylonian captivity is child's play, if you will return, if you will recollect what you should have done, you didn't do, where you should have been, you were not there, and the loyalty you should have had, and the love you should have had, and the faithfulness you have had, you didn't have. If you recollect, if you repent, and if you now renew your consecration, commitment unto me, then I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you, I caused you to be carried away captive. And so that's the prediction of the captivity because of their unfaithfulness. How about today? What happens to us? Does anybody ever go to captivity today? Well, there are different kinds of captivity. Look at Isaiah chapter 5, and we're looking at verse 13. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 13, therefore, my people are gone into captivity. Therefore, there is something. Captivity does not just come out of the blue, out of the sky, and affliction does not rise for no reason. There will be a reason that the covenant people of God, the good people of God, good old days, and the favorite people of God, and the peculiar treasure of God, there's a reason why they will go into captivity. It says, therefore, my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. The knowledge of the salvation of the Lord, the knowledge of the character of God, the knowledge of the important thing in the hand of God. You need to have that knowledge, and the knowledge of following the Lord faithfully. They need to have the knowledge, you say, because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst. It even goes beyond this. Look at verse 14. In verse 14 it says, therefore hell has enlarged herself. Hell was not expecting so many passengers, so many pilgrims, and so many candidates, but because the people of God, they lack the knowledge of righteousness and the knowledge of holiness and the knowledge of the demand and the decree and the desire of the Lord, and then they follow the wrong way now. Because of that, they go to captivity, and some of them die in the captivity, not only captivity of Babylon, but the captivity of sin and the captivity of evil. Therefore, hell has enlarged herself and opened her mouth without measure, and their glory and their multitude and their pomp, and he that rejoices shall descend into it. That was unfortunate for them. Look at number two there. Number two there is the perplexing condition of an unseen period. They never envisaged this, that if such a time will come, they were perplexed. They were confused. How could this happen? Look at Isaiah chapter 22. We're reading from verse 5. Isaiah chapter 22, verse 5. For it is a day of trouble and of treading down and of perplexity by the Lord God of hosts in the valley of vision, breaking down the walls and crying to the mountains. It says, as the captivity came upon them, they were shocked. They were confused. How could God do this? And this Babylon is a sinful, terrible nation. And Nebuchadnezzar is an idol worshiper. At least they thought, we are still worshiping the Lord. Even though we're not perfect, even though we're not doing everything right, but how can God use somebody worse than us to come and replace us? And he'll lift that person up, and we will be under his boot. And he'll be, you know, he'll be treading upon us. They were perplexed because they did not foresee that period, that God will use any instrument to bring down the pride of somebody or nation who is against him. Look at Psalm 137. In Psalm 137, it tells us in verse 3, it says in verse 3, for they that carried us away captive required of us a song. They were singing the songs of the Lord. You know, if you read the Psalms, I was singing a new song unto the Lord. And they were happy in the Lord. When they came out of the Red Sea, they burst into singing. And they were singing, God is great and God is glorious. And when they overcame in Judges, chapter 4, chapter 5, Deborah and Barak and all of them, they started singing unto the Lord. And when Goliath was crushed and conquered, David was so, the women, they came together, they were singing to the Lord. Christianity is singing religion, and the Jewish people were singing people. Look at Jehoshaphat there, for the Lord is good, and he is good for to everyone. And then praise be unto the Lord, praise be unto the Lord, bless his holy name. They were singing, and while they were singing, the enemies were now being conquered. Now they came to a perplexing time. The songs they had sung that brought joy, that brought happiness, the songs they had sung that brought, you know, lifting up for them, the enemies that carried them captive required of them a song. And they that wasted us required of us meat, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, they say, but how shall we sing the song, the Lord's song, in a strange land? They were now strangers in the place where they were actually now. Nebuchadnezzar and the people that carried them captive, they wanted them to forget Jerusalem, Forget Judah. Forget all those songs who are singing to God. Your Creator will teach you our own kind of song. Look at verse 5. It says in verse 5, if I forget thee, O Jerusalem, that's what the Babylonians want to do. They want us to forget God and forget Jerusalem, the capital city and the holy city of God. And they were now in the land of strangers. They were now saying, if I forget thee, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget Iconium. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, if I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my tongue. If I do not remember you, I will not sing any song. Let my tongue cleave to the root of my mouth, to the roof of my house. That is, they said, if we're not going to sing the song of Zion, no other singing. If we're not going to talk about Jerusalem, happy Jerusalem, holy Jerusalem, and the new Jerusalem above, if we cannot think of that, if we cannot purposefully go in that direction, let us not even talk to anybody. If we cannot talk about Jehovah, if we cannot talk about his goodness, about his blessing, about his salvation, if we cannot talk about his power and his sovereignty, we're not going to even talk about anything anymore on earth. They said, if I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. If I prefer not Jerusalem above my chief joy. That's what they should have done when they were back at home. When everything was all right, when they woke up in the morning and they said, praise the Lord, if the Lord had did this for, when God gave them food and clothing and shelter and everything, and when he put protected them everywhere. That's what they should have done. They should have understood that the city of the living God should be above their chiefest joy. They should also have understood that they remember Jerusalem, remember God, remember everything about God every time. But now perplexity came unto them. I pray perplexity will not come to you. That what we should have done, what God is favorable, what the opportunities are there, and why the good things are there for us, what we should have done, we do, rather than being careless, and then we allow captivity to come, and then we're perplexed, and we're in a strange land, in a place where we cannot sing the song of Zion. Look at Micah, Micah chapter 7, I'm reading from verse 4. In Micah chapter 7, verse 4, the best of them is as a briar, and most upright is sharper than a thorn edge. The day of thy watchmen and thy visitation cometh, now shall be their perplexity. Now shall be their perplexity. When they should have been soft, they were harsh, harsh and hardened. And when they should have been helpful, they were hurtful. When they should have been hopeful, they were hopeless. And when they should have joyfully followed the Lord and joyfully obeyed the word of the Lord, they were like briars and thorns in the sight of the Lord. And because of that, now shall be their perplexity. I about those of us who are living on earth today. Any perplexity? Look at Luke chapter 21. We're reading from verse 25. Luke chapter 21. And we're reading from verse 25. And the Lord Jesus Christ himself was the one that said this. And he said, there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity. Distress of nations with perplexity. You might have heard, if you are scientific mind oriented, about heart warming. You might have heard about the pollution of the air. You might have heard about how this world is not taking care of us as it should take care of us. You might have heard that the air we breathe today, because of the industrial age, the air we breathe today is not as pure as the air the many people hundreds of years ago that were breathing. You might have heard that even the fruits of the ground growing up, the earth is depleted. And because of that, what we are getting, the scientists are concerned. Even those who are not Christian, by just studying, they are saying they don't know how much time we still have on this earth. Meanwhile, the population of the world is increasing, and the world, the earth, is not able to support everybody. The knowledgeable people, they're perplexed already. What do we do? And the diseases are multiplying. You will think that, you know, the more we are civilized and the farther we go, you'll think the healthier we should become. Look at the knowledge we have. You can check up anything now. You just Google that and search that. You'll get the information. And yet with all that, we're sicker today in the world than they were at that time. We are perplexed. And it says the things that will be happening to the sun, things that will be happening to the moon, and the distress of nations, nation against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And then it says with perplexity. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, it says men's heart failing them. Have you heard people have just heart attack and they are gone? They appeared healthy yesterday. They appeared healthy last week. And they were, you know, maybe doing something. They just slumped and they collapsed. They are gone. And it's happening at a greater rate than it used to happen. The people that have high blood pressure has become something that is very, very high now. All over the world, you think it's only those of us over here in Africa, because we don't take care of this, we don't take care of that, that's why we have that. But now, over the America, Europe, everywhere, is one of the terrible killers of people, whether in the West or in the South and in the North, anywhere. That's where we are today, because men's hearts are failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, and the powers of the sky, of the heavens, of the galaxies, of the planets shall be shaken. Let's look at number three. Number three, we're looking at the painful consequence of an unfixed past. Unfixed past. Actually, for the people of Judah, the Lord told them, he said, you'll plow the land for 6 years. The seventh year, the land will rest. And, you know, they said, who can follow that kind of principle? But their forefathers followed that. Every seventh day, they will gather the manna for 6 days. If they gathered on the seventh day, if they try to gather, they will not get, because God wanted for them that seventh day to be free. And then if they let it over on the sixth day to the seventh day, it will breed worms. And he wanted that also for the land, that the land will rest 1 year after 6 years of cultivation. They did not. And so God was looking at them. He was patient with them. For 470 years, they continued like that. And God said, enough. You see, a sinner can go on sinning and sinning. One day God will say, that's enough. A sinner can keep on rebelling, revolting against the Lord. One day God says, that is enough. At the end of 490 years, the Lord said, you should have kept 1 year out of seven, 1 year out of seven. And so he divided 490 by seven, and he got 70. He said, I'll send you to captivity, and then the land will rest for the 70 years. That's what happened to them. It's the painful consequence of an unfixed past. The past, they didn't fix up properly. Jeremiah chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 12. Jeremiah chapter 2, verse 12. Be astonished, O ye heavens, at this, and be horribly afraid, be ye very desolate, says the Lord. Look at verse 13. In verse 13, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and hewed them out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. They were trying to replace the word of God, the law of God, with their own ideas and opinions. And the Lord said, they're broken cisterns, they're cracked, they're human. They will not last. They will not hold any water. I gave you something perfect. I gave you my word. I gave you my will. You're forsaking that and you're following after broken cisterns. Look at verse 14. In verse 14, is Israel a servant? I called you son. I told Pharaoh, let my son go. But now, is Israel a servant? Is he a homeborn slave? Why? Is he spoiled? Look at verse 17. In verse 17, hast thou not procured this unto thyself? It's not my fault. I love you. It's not my fault. I wanted you to be my favorite son, my favorite nation, all through until the end of the world. But you have procured this unto thyself, in that thou hast forsaken the Lord thy God when he led thee by the way. Look at verse 19. In verse 19, thine own wickedness shall correct thee. I try to correct you by word of mouth, but you will not listen. All right? Your action, your behavior, the consequence of your character and your wickedness shall correct thee, and thy backslidings, in the plural, your backslidings shall reprove thee. Know therefore and see that it is an evil sin and bitter that thou hast forsaken the Lord thy God, and that my fear is not in thee, says the Lord God of hosts. It tells us in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 15, many things that are piled up in the past. We've done that and God appears quiet. We do another thing, God appears silent. And then we go ahead and we're testing God. We're testing the genuineness of the law of God. We're testing the might of God. We're testing the sincerity of God. We say, I've done that, now I've conquered him, I've conquered God. Because as I did that, and other people did that, and other people did that, and we transfer it one to the other. If God is going to judge anyone, he's going to judge everybody. And now we're paralyzing. He cannot do what he said he will do. They didn't know that God is long-suffering, not willing that anyone should perish. But the day of reckoning will come. Look at this in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 15. That which has been is now, and that which is to be has already been, and God requires that which is past, and God requires that which is past. God was saying, Israel, what did I tell you? Rest one day out of seven. Judah, what did I tell you? Rest one year out of seven. By the way, do you know that is why some workers are allowed, especially lecturers at universities, is sabbatical. It's the Bible principle. He has been teaching and lecturing and researching, doing everything for 6 years. They say, now you can go. They're still employed there. There's still lecturers there. There's still, you know, employees there. But go for 1 year, then come back again. Be refreshed. Isn't that what you should do? Isn't that why we have the Lord's Day? We walk for 6 days, and then the seventh day, we worship the Lord. We read the Bible. We revive ourselves. We pray, and we kind of rejuvenate so that before Monday, we're fresh again. We were tired and weak at the end of the week, but now we're calm, and this day, it's not a day to keep on running. Some people just keep on running and running and running. It will tell. It will tell. Because God will say, no rest at all. They will not even sleep the time they ought to sleep. God requires that which is past. It is good we're born again. It's good we're children of God. But you know, we've been, if you have been smoking and drinking for years, and the tissues, they're worn down, the cells, they're broken down, and everything you have, even DNA is affected, and all the body is affected, and you keep on and keep on, God will forgive, God will forgive. They keep on drinking, God will forgive. Yes, God will forgive. But what of the damage you've done to your body, to your system, to your brain, to your nerves, to your cells, and to everything that you have within you, all those many years, the earlier you repent, the better. It is for your good, because God requires that which is past. There are, you know, young people, they should go to school, and they go to school, of course, and then at school, they don't read, they are just following gangs and following this and that, and they say, I know myself, I have the brain. When the exam is coming, I just read and cram, I'll make it. And now they've wasted almost 6 years in the secondary school, and now the exam is coming, and they want to burn the midnight oil. God requires that which is past. All throughout the year, we live a life of carelessness. And then we say, at the end of the year, December 31st, we're going to make resolution. And resolution, it doesn't work that way. Because, you see, all those things we have done during the year, they become habitual. And we cannot just change the habit like that. God requires that which is past. We have to go back to God, and we have to say, Lord, we understand what we've done. The past has been terrible. We've weakened ourselves. We've destroyed ourselves. Because we'll take that past to the Lord, and we'll say, Lord, forgive. And thank God, a loving God, he will forgive everyone. And then we say, God, renew my youth and renew my life. Thank God, he has the power. If you go to God in good time, he will renew you in Jesus' name. We're looking at Romans chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 23. Romans chapter 3, we're looking at verse 23. For all have sinned, that the past, the past of many people, bad, terrible. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Look at verse 25. In verse 25, it says, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. That's what Christ came to deal with, so that he can revive us again, he can renew us again. All those past things, he wants to forgive. Why don't you bring them to the Lord? All the past things that destroyed us, he wants to remove them and give you a new life. Why don't you come to him? Because he removes, he has remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. I pray that in new life will come to you. A new strength, a new energy will come to you. A new focus, a new vision will come to you in Jesus' name. And this year will not be like last year. I'm saying that today will not be like 3-4 days ago. Something new will happen to you. New life will come to you. A new energy and strength will come to you in Jesus' name. We'll come to point number two now. Point number two, the character of the chosen amidst pollution. We're dividing this into three parts. Number one, deportation by the Chaldeans to the land of corruption. Number two, desperation of corruptors to lead into corruption. Number three, Daniel and his companions, learners who are not corruptible. We're coming to number one. Number one is deportation by the Chaldeans to the land of corruption. Daniel chapter 1, we're looking at verse 3. Daniel chapter 1, we're looking at verse 3. It says that the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, it says, children in whom was no blemish. In whom children, in whom was no blemish, the Lord God of heaven hath preserved some people that they will be without blemish so that they can serve him. But this man, the chief, the king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, wanted those people prepared by God and prepared for God. He wanted them to serve him rather than serving God. Children in whom was no blemish, but well-favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge, clever, sharp, knowledgeable, and in understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the language, the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. You know what they were doing? They wanted to brainwash them. They wanted to clear away from their mind everything they had known about the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. They wanted to push all that aside. They even gave them their own Babylonian names so that they will not remember their names related to the Almighty God. They didn't want that to remain with them. They wanted to clear off everything they knew before, and they wanted them to follow the corruption of of Nebuchadnezzar and of Babylon. But the question is, why did that happen? How did that happen in our lives? When we're saying that children somewhere, we should think what we want our children to go and learn, and what world view we want our children to go and get. Just say education, education, education. That's what they presented to them. But you see, education alone is not enough for life. We need, our lives is not just bread and butter. Our life, social life, our life, marital life, our life, family life, our life, professional life, our life, Christian life, spiritual life. We must take everything into consideration. But now, what were they wanting to do? How did this happen? The deportation by the Chaldeans to the land of corruption. Look at Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 39. We're reading from verse 1. Isaiah 39 verse 1. At that time, Merodach Baladan. What a name. The son of Baladan, king of Babylon at that time, sent letters and presents to Hezekiah, for he had heard that he had been sick and was recovered. Look at verse 2. In verse 2 it says, and Hezekiah was glad of them and showed them the house of his precious things. And then he goes on to say, the silver and the gold and the spices and the precious ointment and all the house of his armor and all that was found in his treasures. There was nothing in his house nor in all his dominion, his kingdom, that Hezekiah showed them not. That the origin of the problem of Judah. Hezekiah was their king. He was sick to the point of death. Isaiah came to him and said, set your house in order. You will die, you will not live. He turned to the wall and he prayed and he said, oh God, remember how perfectly I've served you, and I don't want to die now. God said, Isaiah, go back to him and tell him I will heal him. I give him 15 years extra. And this Hezekiah, after he got well, the king of Babylon at that time came to him and sent letters, sent emissaries and letters. And he was so happy that the unbelievers, the sinners, they appreciated his getting well. And he said, don't go yet. I will show you all that I possess. All the things in itself, from room to room, apartment to apartment, chamber to chamber. He went everywhere and showed them everything. And they were nodding their heads. This is great. You are great kings. I don't go yet. All the things of the kingdom, the authority he had, the substance he had, everything he had, he showed them everything. Look at verse 3 now. In verse 3 it says, then came Isaiah the prophet unto King Hezekiah and said unto him, what said these men, and from whence came they unto thee? And Hezekiah said, they are come from a far country unto me, even from Babylon. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, then said he, what have they seen in thine house? And Hezekiah answered, all that is in my house have they seen. There is nothing among my treasures that I have not showed them. Look at verse 5. Verse 5 says, then Isaiah said to Hezekiah, hear the word of the Lord of hosts. Verse 6, behold, the days come that all that is in thine house and that which thy fathers have laid up in store, until this day shall be carried to Babylon, nothing shall be left, says the Lord. Verse 7 says, and of thy sons, the descendants, that's how Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego got involved, and thy sons that shall issue from thee, even the children he had not given birth to, which thou shalt beget, shall they take away, and they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. Now, what should Hezekiah do hearing that? Because when Asa told him, you will die, set your house in order, he cried, he wept, I've lived a perfect life, I will not die now. And God answered his prayer. What did he say when God told him, everything you showed them, all that your fathers have gathered, everything they will take away? Look at verse 8 now. It says in verse 8, then said Hezekiah to Isaiah, good in the word of the Lord. That's all right. God has said, they'll take everything. That's okay. All your children, the descendants, they'll take them. That's okay. Look at that. What kind of prayer do we pray? When it comes to healing, how do we pray? How do we claim the promises of God? When God now says, everything that your forefathers have gathered, every good thing you have had, every opportunity you have had, every, you are going to lose everything. Okay. That's God. Whatever he wants to do, I'm all right, you are not all right. Look at the consequence. That's what it says now. It says, for there shall, it says, that's okay. Because he said, moreover, for there shall be peace and truth in my days. My friend, that is selfish. Look at Isaiah chapter 52, and we're reading from the first part of verse 3. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 3, for thus says the Lord, ye have sold yourselves for naught. It was their fault. You have sold yourself for naught. Why don't you look at your life this new year? What have I lost? What made me to lose those things? How did I sell myself? How did I sell my opportunities? How did I sell my future? How did I sell my destiny? In a way, I shouldn't have done that. That's what the Lord is saying. The Lord is saying, check up. Because in the case of Judah, the deportation to the land of corruption is that they sold themselves for nothing. Let's look at number two here. Number two, we're looking at desperation of corruptors to lead into corruption. The Babylonians were desperate. All they wanted to do was to corrupt all these people of Judah. Daniel chapter 1, we're reading from verse 3. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes. Look at verse 4. In verse 4, you see children in whom there was no blemish and but well-favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability. They have the stature, they have the posture, they have the knowledge, they have the decorum, they have everything to stand in the presence of the king in the palace. And then it says, whom we might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, and the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. That's scholarship. They give them scholarship, all those young men, young women they brought from Judah unto Babylon. Their food paid for, accommodation paid for, and textbooks paid for. Everything they needed paid for. That was scholarship. But watch. The scholarship is to turn their mind away from God. The scholarship is to make them have the culture and the condition and the situation and the learning and the mindset of the Babylonians. They were so desperate in wanting to corrupt them, and they had the money and they had the facilities. So they used all the money and the facilities to corrupt them. Amos chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 11. In Amos chapter 2, verse 11, I raised up your sons for prophets, and of your young men for Nazarites. Is it not even thus, O ye children of Israel, says the Lord? The Lord raised up their sons. He wanted them to be prophets. He wanted them to be teachers of the word. He wanted them to be Nazarites, totally committed, consecrated unto the Lord. And God said, that's how I raised up your sons and your children. Is that not so, O Israel? What did they do? Look at verse 12. In verse 12, but ye gave the Nazarites wine to drink. Even you yourselves, I wanted your children to be clean, to be pure, and then to be profitable to me and the kingdom of God. But you gave those your own children that I'm raising up as prophets and as Nazarites, you gave them wine to drink, and you commanded the prophets, saying, prophesy not. And I wanted them to prophesy. I wanted them to be my channel that will reveal my revelation. But you said, no, our children will not be prophets, will not be preachers, will not be pastors. Look at verse 13. In verse 13, it says, behold, I am pressed under you. God said, I'm disappointed, I'm pressed, I'm displeased, because I want your children to be good, righteous, holy, godly, and then to serve me. But you corrupted even your own children. He said, I am pressed under you as a cat is pressed that is full of sheaves. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 4. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 4, a sinful nation, a people laden with iniquity, a seed of evildoers, children that are corruptors in their own land, in Judah. They corrupted their own people with ideas, ideologies, and philosophies, and psychology, and idolatry, and tradition, every evil thing. And they borrowed all the ideologies of the unbelievers and of the world and of the Gentiles into their land, and they became corruptors. They have forsaken the Lord. They have provoked the Holy One of Israel unto anger. They are gone away backward. That's the reason why, okay, you've gone into corruption. I wasn't expecting this. I'll take you to where you see you're looking for corruption. You'll get it there. And it took them to Babylon. And those Babylonians, they were really at it to bring corruption to them, to corrupt and to destroy all their children. Hosea chapter 9, we're looking at verse 9. Hosea chapter 9, we're looking at verse 9. In verse 9, it says, they have deeply corrupted themselves. The children of Israel, the people of Judah, they have deeply corrupted themselves as in the days of Gibeah. Therefore, he will remember their iniquity. He will visit their sin. That is the reason why God allowed them to be taken to Babylon, so that they'll be totally corrupted. Look at verse 17. In verse 17, my God will cast them away because they did not hearken unto him. They did not hearken unto him. Believers, children of God, that should listen to God. And when God had made all the sacrifices necessary to make them clean, make them acceptable, make them pure and prepare them for glory. But instead of that, God said, my God will cast them away. Why? Because they did not hearken unto him, and they shall be wanderers among the nations. So we're coming to number three here. Number three, Daniel and his companions, learners who are not corruptible. Yet they wanted to suck in Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the system of Babylon. Corrupt them, make them unfit to live with God on earth, unfit to go to God in heaven. But these people, Daniel and his companions, were not corruptible. We're looking at Daniel chapter 1, reading from verse 6. In verse 6, they say, now, among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Ananias, Mishael, and Azariah. Look at verse 7. In verse 7, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names. For he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Ananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and of Azariah of Abednego. Those were the companions, but they were companions in purity, companions in prayer, companions in purposefulness, companions in perseverance, companions of remaining with the Lord and saying, this is where we stand. And look at Daniel chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 17. Daniel chapter 2, verse 17. Then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Ananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions. They were companions together, companions in following the Lord, companions in doing the will of the Lord. Look at verse 18. In verse 18, it says that they would desire mercies of the Lord of heaven concerning the secret that Daniel and his fellows, his friends, his companions should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Let's look at chapter 3. We're looking at verse 15. Daniel chapter 3, verse 15. This is Nebuchadnezzar now calling them and saying, I set up my idol, and if you don't worship him, this is what I will do. But remember, Daniel and his companions had the same conviction and the same courage and the same mindset. They were going to worship God. They were not going to worship any idol. And it says in Daniel chapter 3 verse 15, now, if ye be ready at what time ye hear the sound of the cornet and also of the flute and harp and sackbut and psaltery and dulcimer and all kinds of music, idolatrous music, ye fall down and worship the image which I have made. Well, but If ye worship not, ye shall be cast the same hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Look at verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said unto the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful, we're not anxious, and we're not fearful, we're not timid to answer thee in this matter. Look at verse 17. If it be so, if it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. Then in verse 18, but if not, even if he will not deliver us, if he prefers that we burn in that furnace and then go from the furnace and go to paradise and go to heaven, that's all right. They said, but if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Those are good companions. What kind of companion do you have? What kind of friends do you have? What kind of associates do you have? Who are you intimate with? Who do you talk to almost every day, almost every week? Are they people that have the same conviction as you have? The same courage as you have? The same consecration as you have? Do you have companions that will stand for God through thick or thin, whatever? Or are they compromisers? Because birds of the same feather, they flock together. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 33. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. If your companions are evil, if your companions are wayward, if your companions are defiled and defiling people, if your companions are disobedient and rebellious people, if your companions are deceptive people, and being deceived as well, you will take on their character. Because it says, be not deceived, evil communications corrupt good manners. Verse 34, it says, awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. We're coming to point number three now. Point number three is the courage of conviction with purposeful purity. The courage of conviction with purposeful purity. Look at chapter 1 of Daniel. We're looking at verse 8. Daniel chapter 1. And we're looking at verse 8. It says, but Daniel purposed in his heart. Purposed in his heart. That's the seat of decision. That's the center of decision. It's not the mind. It's not the head. It's not the eyes. I read. That doesn't make a person a firm, courageous man, woman of conviction. It's when that knowledge you read about, that thing you hear about, goes from your mind, from your head, and goes to your heart. And your heart takes a decision at the very center of your being. And you say, this is who I am, a child of God. This is how I will live. You decide that before the day of temptation. You decide that before the day of corruption. You decide that before you get to that office, before you get to that market. If you don't take the decision on your knees at home, if you don't have the conviction before the Lord at home, and then you settle it with the Lord, this is the way I'm going to live. Whatever I gain, whatever I lose, this will be my life. And then you have the grace of God in your life to be saved. The grace of God that sanctifies you, settle that. Now you can go out. Whatever happens already, the decision has been made already. The conviction is obtained already. The courage is inside there. And when the challenge now comes, we'll be able to build on that conviction, build on that courage. It's about Daniel purpose purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Why? The meat and the wine had been sacrificed to their idols. That's their position and their practice in the land of corruption in Babylon. So he purposed that he's not going to take that. And he says, therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he would not defile himself. He requested. You know, some people say, okay, I don't want to do that. I will put the fleece down. If that person does not call me, then I know I will not do it. If that person did not text me, then I know I will not do it. If he don't send a chat, then I will not. No! You're the one to make up your mind. Whatever he sends, whatever he does, whatever he asks, you say, I have this conviction. You're not putting any fleece down. Salvation doesn't work by fleece. Sanctification doesn't work by fleas. You make up your mind that you will not defile yourself. We're looking at three things here. Number one, the purposeful heart cleansed from all defilement. Number two, the purified heart, courageous against acknowledged defilement. What I mean by acknowledged defilement is, already Nebuchadnezzar acknowledged the wine, acknowledged the meat, acknowledged the idol. And so those people who are taking it, it's an acknowledged thing. And you call it defilement, okay? Call it defilement, it's acknowledged defilement. Even then, anybody can approve of it. Anybody can recommend it. Anybody can do it. Anybody can acknowledge it, or affirm it, or confirm it. He, Daniel, still made up his mind. He was not going to have anything to do with acknowledged defilement. Number three, the persevering heart consecrated without any defilement. Look at number one. Number one is the purposeful heart cleansed from all defilement. I've read it already, but look at Psalm 119. We're reading from verse 1. In Psalm 119, verse 1, blessed are they that are undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Verse 2 says, in verse 2, blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. In verse 3, it tells us in verse 3, they also do no iniquity. Iniquity coming from the palace, they do no iniquity. Iniquity coming from the king, give this to them, tell them, I, the king, the emperor, I send this to them. Iniquity coming from the chief and from the emperor, from the king of Babylon, they do no iniquity. Iniquity coming from a friend. Iniquity coming from a favorite. Iniquity coming from somebody, a bosom friend. No, I cannot do that. This will separate us because I made up my mind and I have a purposeful heart cleansed already from all defilement, and they do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. Look at verse 9. Wherewith shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to thy word. How do we cleanse our ways? We hear the word of God, we take that word to the Lord, and we allow the blood of Jesus to cleanse us and purge and purify us. And then from there on, we have a purposeful heart that we're not going to defile ourselves. Mark chapter 7, I'm reading from verse 20. Mark chapter 7, and we're looking at verse 20. It says in verse 20, and he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. Wine, yes, defiles the man. The meat of Babylon defiles the man. Idolatrous, something is sacrificed to idol. And for us to take that, that defiles the man. But more than that, in verse 21, it says, for from within, out of the heart of men proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders. Verse 22, and thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lying, deception, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. Verse 23, it says, all these evil things come from within and they defile the man. And so our decision, our dedication, our devotion, our consecration is that any of these things will not have any part in our lives, because we're not going to defile ourselves. Look at number two here. Number two, the purified heart, courageous against acknowledged defilement. We're looking at Acts chapter 15, verse 9, and put no difference between us and them, us Jews and them Gentiles, purifying their hearts by faith. We're saved and we're pardoned by faith. We're sanctified, we're purified by faith. After we have been saved, we go back to the Lord. He who had done the first work of grace, he will do the second work of grace as well. He'll purify, he'll sanctify, purifying their hearts by faith. And what it does is, there's something in the heart, natural. There's something in the heart, Adamic. There's something in the heart, depraved. Even though our external sins had been forgiven, there is that thing in the heart that will lean towards the Adamic nature. There's something in the heart that will lean towards the depraved nature. There's something in the heart that will lean towards all those internal secret things, and they will contradict the grace of God and the nature of God in our lives. But when we go back to God after we're saved, when we go back to God after, as we're sanctified, and we say, God, sanctify, purify, cleanse our hearts, then that is done, and then he cleanses us and purifies us. I pray he'll do it for every one of us. Look at Ezekiel chapter 36, and I'm reading from verse 25. Ezekiel chapter 36, reading from verse 25, but then will I sprinkle clean water upon you. This is not what Ezekiel will do. This is what God will do. And ye shall be clean, and from all your idols, and from all your idols and filthiness will I cleanse you. That's salvation. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, a new heart also will I give you. A new heart also. That means I have done the first one. I have cleansed you from all your idols, from all your filthiness, and all your defilement. Also, after that salvation, it says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart. The one that said, why should I be resisting every day? You know, fighting against sin and fighting against all these corruption every day. I think I'm tired. Let what will happen. He says, no, I'll give you a new heart. That stony heart, I'm tired. That stony heart, I cannot, do that again. I'm going to have my own way. He says, I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. That's sanctification. Verse 25, that's salvation. Verse 26, that's sanctification. Look at verse 27 now. In verse 27, and I will put my spirit within you. Holy Ghost baptism. He wants us to have salvation. He wants us to have sanctification. He wants us to have the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. I pray the grace of God will increase in your life. Amen. Multiply in your life. This new year, a new life, a new direction, a new strength, a new power in Jesus' name. Look at number three there. Number three is the persevering heart, consecrated without any defilement. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were not only there for 1 week, for 1 month. They were there in that college, in that school, in that training that Nebuchadnezzar put them 3 years. And what they said at the beginning, We will not defile ourselves. No defilement will touch our lives. No defilement will come to our lives. All through the 3 years, they were like that because they had a persevering heart. And we're told that Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they came to Babylon. They were brought to Babylon around the age of 18. Some people say 20. And they were there all the time of the captivity, 70 years. Well, you had 70 to 18 or 20. And by the time the captivity was ending, Daniel was about 88 to 90 years. And he still lived beyond the Babylonian captivity. When the Medo-Persian came in, government came in, he was still there. Cyrus came in, he was still there. He was going to nearly 100 years of age. He was still there, but he had a persevering heart. He will not corrupt himself. He will not compromise. He was not tired of following after the Lord all the days of his life. That same strength the Lord will give unto you. We're looking at Jeremiah chapter 32, and we're reading from verse 30. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 38, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. In verse 39, it says, and I will give them one heart, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, the same heart. The same salvation, the same sanctification, and the same commitment, conviction, consecration unto the Lord. I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever. Persevering, permanent, perpetual, that they will fear me forever for the good of them and of their children after them. Look at verse 40. In verse 40 it says, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them, that I will not turn away from them to do them good, but I will put my fear in their hearts, that they shall not depart from me. Persevering heart, they shall not depart from me. And then he says in verse 41, yes, I will rejoice over them to do them good, and I will plant them in this land assuredly with my whole heart and with my whole soul. What he did for them, he'll do it for you in Jesus' name. We're looking at Psalm 139. We're looking at verse 23. Psalm 139. We're looking at verse 23. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. As we come to the end of the study tonight, everyone, you have come because you love God, because you want to serve God. You have come because you want to walk in the way of the Lord. Why don't we ask the Lord, oh Lord, am I like Daniel? Am I like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do I have this purposeful heart? Do I have this purified heart? Do I have this persevering heart? Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Look at verse 24. It says in verse 24, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. What you did for them, that it could stand like that with without any corruption, without any defilement, all through those years, do for us that in this new year we'll be living a bright life, brighter life, better life, higher life, holier life than we ever lived in Jesus' name. Search me, O Lord, try me, know my heart, and lead me in the way everlasting. The Lord will do it for you. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Rise up and open your mouth and say, Lord, here am I. This is what I desire, the life I ought to live now. This is what I desire, the Lord will do it. Pray, believe God, greater year you have this year.
Go to the Lord in prayers. The call. We are in a new year now. Have you answered the call? Called, choosing, and faithful. Make up your mind. Lord, I will be among the choosing. I will be faithful unto you in all things to the end. Want you to call upon the name of the Lord. That whatever challenge you face this year, you will make up your mind to remain pure, to remain undefiled. But you need to watch your own company. Who are your friends? Call upon the name of the Lord. No matter the situation you find yourself in, Babylon, in that place of work, that you remain uncorruptible, whether in captivity or in the free world, you remain pure. Like Daniel, the people try to condition them, but they remain committed to the Lord. Wherever we are, anywhere in the world, make up your mind. Whether in Jerusalem or in Babylon, make up your mind. I will remain uncorruptible. I will remain pure. I will remain undefiled. Call upon the Lord. Pray for grace. Pray for grace. Lord, give me grace to remain undefiled. It's a new year. That from this day, this first Bible study, to the end of your life, you will remain pure like Daniel, like his friends. You will remain upright. Call upon the Lord that your Christian life, you will shine as light wherever you go. No matter the desperation of the corruptors wanting to defy you, wanting to corrupt you, wanting to bring you, suck you in, make up your mind, I will remain pure. Call upon the Lord, pray for grace. Pray for grace. Pray for his strength. Pray that your character, the character of the choosing, even amidst pollution, your character will remain that of pure purity, uprightness. Daniel and his companion, they did not surrender or yield or compromise their Christian stand, their commitment to the Lord, the God of heaven. They did not compromise. They did not say, well, since I'm here, let me do as they do. No, make up your mind, whether here in Africa or Europe or Asia or America or anywhere you find yourself, Canada, anywhere, make up your mind to be pure. Make up your mind. Mind you, the company you keep, your company matters. Are they company who are mindful of remaining pure? Your friends, do they hate sin? Because if you make friends with sinners, evil companionship will corrupt good manner. We see that their companion was in purity. Their companionship was in prayer, and it was purposeful. The purpose was to glorify God, to honor him in all things, to live for him. Pray, brother. Sister, pray. The tendency of backsliding will not be seen in you. That this year, there will be revival, there will be commitment to holiness, commitment to uprightness, commitment to purity. Have you been saved? If you have not been saved, that's where to start. Have you been cleansed? Have your sin been forgiven? Have you been sanctified and made holy? When did it happen? Have you been sanctified? Have your Adamic nature been rooted out? Pray. Like Isaiah, he prayed and his heart, his sin was purged. Call upon the name of the Lord. The people in Cornelius' house, had their heart purified. And the Lord that did it for them is able to do it for us. Pray, purify my heart. If you have got it, pray that it become whiter, bigger, better, purer. Call upon the name of the Lord. They were companion in prayer. Companion in following the Lord. In abiding in the faith, abiding in truth. And they were faithful to the Lord. Pray. Grace to be faithful this year. Faithful in soul winning. Faithful in living for God. Faithful in being ready for the rapture. Who knows when the Lord shall come? Pray. Lord, the word will not suck me up. The word will not contaminate or corrupt me. But upon the Lord, dear brother, sister, whether in the campus or anywhere we are, that God will give you the grace to stand. Stand for the truth. Stand in righteousness. Pray for courage. Courage with conviction. With purposeful purity. Pray for that courage. That when challenges come, maybe in your village, maybe anywhere, you will stand courageously for the truth, for holiness, for uprightness. Brother, pray. Sister, pray. Pray with all your heart. Pray with all sincerity. Pray. This is a new year. Pray for grace. Resolution is not enough. You need grace. Look at Daniel. He proposed in his heart, I will not get defiled. And for years, till almost 100 or more years, he remained undefiled. He remained undefiled. Pray that God will keep you undefiled, uncorruptible, standing for righteousness. Pray. But upon the name of the Lord, let's avoid carelessness. Let's avoid carefree attitude. Stand for the faith. Stand for the truth. Daniel remained undefiled, even at a point that the kings conspired against him, wanting to find a fault. They found no fault. No fault. In your office, let there be no fault. In your school, remain shining, upright, undefiled. Let there be no fault. Let them know that she is a believer. She is a child of God. He is a child of God. Pray for grace. Let's come before the throne of grace that we may receive grace and help. Find help in the time of need. The more grace you have, the more you'll be able to stand and overcome. And overcome temptation, trials, and the pressure that is coming on you to get corrupted, to get compromised. You will say, no, not me. Not me. I will not get defiled. Pray. Pastors pray. Leaders pray. Workers pray. Our new friends pray. Members pray. No matter how long you've been in this race, no matter how long, they say in the world, the higher the cooler. No, let it be the higher the hotter. Let's pray for grace to serve the Lord, to love him, to do his will. That the more I get to know the Lord, the more I know him deeper. The more zealous I am for righteousness. The more zealous I am for truth, for sound doctrine, being faithful. Being uncompromising. Let's call upon the Lord wherever you are, all over the world, on the social media, in various congregations, in your house, wherever. Pray. The Lord that helped Daniel. The Lord that strengthened Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The Lord that gave him the courage and the fearful, the respect, the fearless spirit. The spirit that fears no evil. The spirit that stands for righteousness. The Lord that helped them will help us too. This is our own time. This is our own time. You don't know the last message you will hear before the rapture takes place? Pray that nothing will take you away from the faith. You will remain. Daniel remained until the end. You will remain in righteousness, undefiled, pure, holy, upright, sinless, uncorruptible, till the end. Pray. Surrender yourself. Lord, I surrender. Lord, I give myself to thee. Lord, I will not look back. Lord, I will not compromise. Help me. Help me, Lord. 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 Pray. He will help you. He will give you all the grace as he gave to Daniel and his companions. He will give to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we are grateful, Lord, for this expository teaching you have given us tonight. And you have reminded us we are the called and we are the chosen among the few that are chosen. Lord, we will not toil with our birthright. We will not defile our conscience and our life. Father, we will be faithful unto you to the end in Jesus' name. Father, we know in Christ there is fullness of grace. All the grace we need, as we are assured, Paul the Apostle, my grace is sufficient. The grace to remain undefiled. Give to everyone in Jesus' name. Father, we will not serve you in vain. No matter what the word, the pressure, no matter the pressure they are putting on us, wanting to condition us to their own level, wanting to bring us low, wanting to bring us into corruption, we will never get corrupted in Jesus' name. Others may, we will not. In this new year, we will serve you to the end. Uprightness, righteousness, holiness, purity shall be our character in the day, in the night, in the secret, in the open, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray this night for all our youths, all our children, all our women, all our men, all our friends, grace to stand. The grace to stand. Give to us, Lord, in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for our Father in the Lord. Father, I pray, keep him for us. Strengthen him the more. Energize him the more. Give him abundant grace to keep on revealing your mind to us in Jesus' name. Should the rapture happen any day, maybe before tomorrow, we and he and us, will we make it in Jesus' name? As we go tonight, Lord, let this message keep ringing. And all other messages we have had before, thank you for answer prayers. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen.
away your fear.
You need a new visitation, a new postulation leading to a new proclamation.
What wise men, great men, medical men, professional people have not been able to do, God will do it. All those things that are forgotten, your forgotten strength, your forgotten power, your forgotten revelation, everything you said, I had a dream long ago, and I thought, this is what I will do, I've forgotten now, your forgotten vision will come up again. Will come up again. Revelation will come up again. New life will come up again in your life in Jesus' name.
Only Christ Jesus has the power of this new year.
An unforgettable encounter beckons. We are connecting to the God of wonders this new year for salvation and deliverance. Welcome GCK to Asaba, Delta State, Nigeria, January 26th to 31st, 2023.
1600 hours GMT daily and global Sunday worship at 0700 hours GMT. Also featuring ministers and professionals conference with Impact Academy for youth, young adults and young professionals. It's a new year of wonders this 2023.
From the Niger Delta, the oil of anointing will be transported by satellite and all our social media links to over 150 countries of the world. Join the teeming GCK audience as the man appointed by God, the convener of GCK, Pastor Dr. W.F. Kumoyi, connects the world to an unforgettable encounter with the God of wonders. Glorious music ministrations by choirs from nations across the world, with guest music ministration by Jonathan Lee.
Darkness gone. Yes. Premature death cancelled. Yes. Yours is now to reap the benefit.
GCK, the gospel to every creature.
Rest your mind. Put away your fear.
You need a new visitation, a new postulation leading to a new proclamation.
What wise men, great men, medical men, professional people have not been able to do, God will do it. All those things that are forgotten, your forgotten strength, your forgotten power, your forgotten revelation, everything you said, I had a dream long ago, and I thought, this is what I will do, I've forgotten now, your forgotten vision will come up again. Passion will come up again. Revelation will come up again. New life will come up again in your life in Jesus' name.
Only Christ Jesus has the power of this new year.
An unforgettable encounter beckons. We are connecting to the God of wonders this new year for salvation and deliverance. Welcome GCK to Asaba, Delta State, Nigeria, January 26th to 31st, 2023.
1600 hours GMT daily and global Sunday worship at 0700 hours GMT. Also featuring ministers and professionals conference with Impact Academy for youth, young adults and young professionals. It's a new year of wonders this 2023.
From the Niger Delta, the oil of anointing will be transported by satellite and all our social media links to over 150 countries of the world. Join the teeming GCK audience as the man appointed by God, the convener of GCK, Pastor Dr. W.F. Kumoyi, connects the world to an unforgettable encounter with the God of wonders. Glorious music ministrations by choirs from nations across the world, with guest music ministration by Jonathan Lee.
Darkness gone. Yes. Premature death cancelled. Yes. Yours is now to reap the benefit.
GCK, the gospel to every creature.
Rest your mind. Put away your fear.
We need a new visitation, a new postulation leading to a new proclamation.
What wise men, great men, medical men, professional people have not been able to do, God will do it. All those things that are forgotten, your forgotten strength, your forgotten power, your forgotten revelation, everything you said, I had a dream long ago, and I thought, this is what I will do, I've forgotten now, your forgotten vision will come up again. Passion will come up again. Revelation will come up again. New life will come up again in your life in Jesus' name.
Only Christ Jesus has the power of this new year.
An unforgettable encounter beckons. We are connecting to the God of wonders this new year for salvation and deliverance. Welcome GCK to Asaba, Delta State, Nigeria, January 26th to 31st, 2023.
1600 hours GMT daily and global Sunday worship at 0700 hours GMT. Also featuring ministers and professionals conference with Impact Academy for Youth, Young Adults and Young Professionals. It's a new year of wonders this 2023.
From the Niger Delta, the oil of anointing will be transported by satellite and all our social media links to over 150 countries of the world. Join the teeming GCK audience as the man appointed by God, the convener of GCK, Pastor Dr. W.F. Kumoyi, connects the world to an unforgettable encounter with the God of wonders. Glorious music ministrations by choirs from nations across the world, with guest music ministration by Jonathan Lee.
Darkness gone. Yes. Premature death cancelled. Yes. Yours is now to reap the benefit.
GCK, the gospel to every creature.